Hello everyone, this is International Grandmaster Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslectures.com, and today I'm going to show you a few instructive examples that demonstrate the importance, the significance of active king at the end of the game. So say, if in the beginning of the game our evaluation of the king is based mainly on either the king is safe or not, towards the end of the game the active role of the king increases, and what's more, pretty often the outcome of the game can depend on either the king can contribute, on either the king is active or not. So as for me, the king is one of the most important pieces in any sort of the endgame, and to demonstrate it, please take a look at the following example. Okay, the positions that you can see at the diagram arose from a game between Akiba Rubinstein against Alexander Alekhin, former world chess champion. In the positions that you can see at the diagram, white to move, white seems to be more active at first glance. The rook occupies the sixth rank. At the same time, black looks solid. Black can hold his weaknesses. Right now, the pawn on a7 is weak, for instance, but if white brings the rook to the a-file, black can use his own rook to protect it, or the king can go to the b-file to protect the a7 pawn. So far, it's unclear what can white do to break through in this rook endgame. Akiba Rubinstein, playing white, decided to transfer his king to the king side to attack the black pawn there. And the move that he played was king e2. If you think about it, it seems to be very logical. The king is heading to the h4, g5, h6 squares. In doing so, white can bind the black rook to protect the pawn on h7. And so he can focus on attacking other pawns. And in the game, black played rook f7. Black does not want to leave the f-file. If black is leaving this file, white can bring his own rook to f6 to attack the f5 pawn after he exchanges, playing g takes on f5. But besides rook f7, white has to anticipate what happens if black plays rook c8. Rook c8, it's a very concrete move. It can force a transposition entire pawn endgame. White has to play rook takes on c8. If white plays rook f6 after black plays king e7, the only way to protect the rook is to play g5. But in this case, white reduces the tension on the pawn on f5, so black does not need to take care of this pawn, and he can just activate the rook playing, for instance, rook c3. So black seems to be active enough in this position. Black should be fine. So see, white has to play rook takes on c8, king takes on c8, and we transpose into a pawn endgame. As you know, pawn endgames are very concrete, so we cannot say right now that white is winning. We have to calculate, and the best decision in this position for white is to break through in the center, playing e4 at some point. So white can do it immediately, but in this case, after black plays d takes on e4, f takes on e4, and then f takes on g4, black gets his own protected pass pawn that white cannot win. Next move, black plays h5, and white cannot win the pawn on g4. White can advance his pawn majority in the center, but still without the assistance of the king, he cannot queen any of his pawns. So, because the white king should be in the square of the black's g and h pawns, it cannot go forward so quickly. So black should hold this position. So white has to be accurate, and first white plays g takes on f5, g takes on f5, and then e4. And now if black takes twice, if black plays d takes, f takes, f takes, white plays king e3, and after, let's say, h5, king takes on e4, it's easy to see that the white king is in the square of the black's h pawn. The white king can easily catch it if black pushes it. Whereas the black king cannot stop two white pawns at the same time. Let's illustrate, let's say, black plays king d7, white can go to attack the h-pawn, let's say king f3 and king e6, king g3. Let's say king d5, white just pushes the f pawn, and the pawn on d4 is untouchable, because white just plays f6, f7, and queen his f pawn. Whereas the white king goes to the h4 square next to take the h5 pawn, and white will get the decisive advantage. If black, after white's e4, does not take this pawn, and let's say plays king d8, white can push the pawn to e5. This endgame also should be winning for white. As usually it happens, the protective passed pawn gives the huge advantage in the pawn endgame. Okay, let's go back. In the game, black played rook f7 and white keeps moving the king. White plays king f2, rook f8, king g3. So black does not want to stay passively anymore and he plays rook e8. He counterattacks the pawn on e3 and now white played rook c3. The rook goes down to protect it. White wants to free the king. White does not want to play king f2 back. Rook e7. As before, black cannot play rook c8 because the pawn endgame after rook takes on c8, king takes on c8 and e4 seems to be winning for white. So black played rook e7 and king h4. White is ready to play king g5 on next move, and to prevent it, black plays h6. Now white cannot play either king g5 or king h5, but at the same time white realized that playing h6, black weakened his g6 pawn, and his plan is now to attack this pawn. He wants to bring the rook back to the 6th rank, but before he needs to protect the pawn on e2. So the white king is coming back to protect this pawn, to guard this pawn, whereas his rook can be used to attack the black pawns on the 6th rank. So white plays king g3 and black plays h5 at this point. So black does not want to stay passively. Indeed, if black just keeps his rook on the e-file, white's plan is very straightforward. As I said, next move white plays king f2 and rook c6. Because black cannot normally exchange the rooks, black cannot play rook e6 due to a bad pawn endgame. Black should stay passively, rook g7, but again, white has a lot of choice. White can just play g takes on f5 and takes the pawn on h6, or white can slowly improve his position, transferring the king to the center and playing e4. So black does not want to stay passively and tries to produce a passed pawn, tries to activate his rook using the king side. So black played h5. And guess what? White moved the king back, king h4. So white understands that the g5 square is weak now, and so the king is heading to this square. The king can be used to attack the g6 pawn. Black played rook h7, king g5, f takes, h takes. White has a choice. White has a choice what pawn to take, and the best one is king takes on g4. This move was played in the game. In the case of king takes on g6, black can retreat the rook, let's say rook h8, and he has enough counterplay due to his own passed pawn. So king takes on g4, and black plays rook h1. As before, black does not want to stay passively. If he plays, for instance, rook e7 after king g5, rook e6, white has a very comfortable play. First, he can play rook a3 to attack the pawn on a7. And after, let's say, king d6, not rook takes on a7 immediately because of the pawn on a3. This pawn is hanging. White can further improve his king. White can play king h6. And let's say after rook f6, king g7, rook e6, king f7, black is in the zugzwang. If he moves the rook, white takes the pawn on g6, whereas if he moves the king to the 7th rank, white can take the pawn on a7 with a check. So white seems to be winning. So, black played rook h1, king g5, rook b1. It's black's best chance to attack the b5 pawn. After he takes it, he can finally start moving his pawns on the queen side. And at this point, white played rook a3. I believe it's not the best bet for him. Probably it was better to play king g6, rook takes on b5, and then rook a3. And after a5, king f6, in spite of the fact that black restored the balance, still white's passed seems to be more dangerous. White's king is more active. The king can go to e5 to attack the d5 pawn. Whereas for black, it's not easy to advance his pawns on the queen side. His rook is pretty passive so far, and white still can fight for a win in this position. White, however, played rook a3 immediately, and in the game, black did not realize that right now he had a great chance to equalize, to get a counterplay. In the game, he played rook b5, and after rook takes on a7, king d6, king takes on g6, rook b3, f5, rook takes on a3 and f6, white eventually won this game. As you can see, white's passed pawn seems to be very dangerous, only two squares to queen it. White has active king. White converted his advantage eventually. But let's go back to the position before black played rook takes on b5. Again, at this point, if black considers alternatives, if black thinks about his king, he can figure out that there is king e6 move, and this move allows black to activate his own king, allows black to limit the white king, which is also very important, because if white can keep the king in the center of the board, it can attack black pawns, it can easily support his own passed pawns. So the best bet for black at this point was king e6, and let's see why. So white has a choice at this point. White can play rook takes on a7, or white can take the pawn on g6, but in both cases black has the same ideas. For instance, if white starts with king takes on g6, after rook g1 check, let's say king h5, king f5, black is threatening to checkmate in one, bringing the rook to the h file, king h6, king f6, let's say king h7. Now if black plays king f7, there is rook a7 check, but instead if black just plays, for instance, rook g7 check, king h8 and rook g3, black has enough counterplay attacking the white pawn on e3. The white king is too bad at the corner of the board, cannot contribute in white's game. So black has excellent chances to make a draw in this position. If instead of king takes on g6, white prefers rook takes on a7, black actually does the same. Still rook g1 check. And let's say after king h6, king f6, again rook h1 is the main threat, king h7. The best bet for black at this point is just g5. Black exchanges his pawn weakness. And after f takes on g5, rook takes on g5, let's say rook b7. Black has a choice. Black can play rook g3, rook b6, king f5, activating the king, or alternatively just rook h5, king g8, rook h3, and after rook takes on b6, king e7, the black king is guarding the squares on the e-file, so white cannot protect the e3 pawn, and after black takes it, he should hold the game. Okay, as you could see, playing king e6, activating the king, black could hold the game. That's it about this example. Let's switch to the next one. Okay, the next rook endgame is from my own game. I was playing white against Grandmaster Brunel. As you can see, white is a pawn up. At the same time, rook endgames are very drowish pretty often, and as you can see, the black king seems to be pretty active, attacking my pawn on h6, attacking another pawn on g4. The black rook is pretty active, cutting off the white king and attacking the pawn on b3. So it looks pretty drowish, but black has to be very accurate, and actually this position is very tricky. First of all, black cannot take the pawn on g4. If black takes this pawn immediately, he is losing immediately because of a tactical trick. White plays rook e4 check, and after, let's say, king g5 or king h5, the idea is the same. White sacrifices the rook, rook h4. And if black takes it, after h7, the pawn is unstoppable. Black cannot use the rook to stop it, the black king is too far away, so white should be winning after white queens the pawn. In the game, black played rook d2, and after king c1, rook h2. So black decided to exchange his two pawns, his b and d pawns, for the white's kingside pawns, in a hope that he can hold, he can manage a draw, playing against only white's pawn on the b file. But as for me, it was a mistake, and actually I believe this position is already winning for white. I played rook e4, he played d3, and after rook takes on b4, king takes on h6, rook d4, black cannot hold the d-pawn, king g5, rook takes on d3, king g4, I played rook d2, black cannot exchange the rook so far because the king is too far away. If he plays rook takes on d2, after king takes on d2, king f5, king c3, my king goes in the front of the pawn, and this pawn endgame is easily winning. He played rook h8. I played king c2, and after rook c8, king b2, king f4, rook d5, very important move. My rook is cutting off the black king. The black king cannot go down, cannot be in the front of the white pawn, and this position is a theoretically winning endgame. White keeps the rook on the fifth rank, and black cannot do anything to stop the pawn. At some point I start pushing it, I play b4, and if black moves the rook, I check, rook c5, and now my rook is heading to the sixth rank, king d5, b5, I repeat the same procedure. The black king cannot help black to stop the pawn, so I won this game eventually. Okay, let's go back to see what could black do instead of rook d2 check. Okay, we are back to the initial position. So, rook d2, not the best bet for black in this position, and the best continuation is linked to active king, and the best move is king f4 at this point. And actually this move seems to be pretty logical. Black tries to bring the king closer to the center. It can help him to protect his d pawn. The black king can be used to limit the white king, and even at some point black can try to arrange mating attacks against the white king. And as analysis shows, it allows black to hold the game. For instance, if at this point white plays h7, black continues with rook d2 check, and after king c1, rook h2, the pawn on h7 is hanging. If white protects it by means of rook e7, black pushes his own passed pawn, and it looks also very dangerous. Otherwise, if white tries to get the black's d pawn, black now can protect it using the king. Black plays king e3, and it helps him to limit the white king. Now if white protects the pawn and plays rook d7, black can just do a perpetual check, playing rook h1, rook h2 back. The white king is in the box and cannot escape the black's checks. The similar variations can occur if instead of h7, white plays rook d6 immediately, attacking the black d pawn. Again, black can proceed with king e3, and actually it can lead to the same position if white plays h7, rook d2 check, king c1, rook h2. And again, black is threatening to play rook takes on h7, and another idea is to do perpetual check, playing rook h1, rook h2 back. So, and black can make a draw. Okay, that's it for today. I hope my examples can help you to master your endgame technique. Never ignore the king in the endgame. It was Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslectures.com.